just get started without further ado. And we're going to start with Tess Hayes. So Tess Hayes is joining us. She's part of the EPA Victoria's Citizen Science team working in the Latrobe Valley in Victoria. She coordinates EPA Citizen Science projects in that region and involves citizen scientists in monitoring air and water quality. So Tess, would you like? Oh, yeah.
I couldn't find you.
Hi, I'm Tess Hayes from EPA Victoria, as mentioned. I'm just going to get right into it. I'm going to speak today about a subject that's quite close to my heart. It's called Harnessing Community Knowledge Through Citizen Science, Co-Design, Co-Monitoring and Co-Interpretation in Practice. I'm going to describe this to you through a current project of ours called Caring for Waterhole Creek. Caring for Waterhole Creek is a water quality monitoring project involving 14 citizen scientists who monitor water quality fortnightly at 10 different sites. Waterhole Creek runs through the town of Morwell in the Latrobe Valley in West Gippsland, Victoria. Why citizen science? We had a government mandate to engage with the community, and EPA saw citizen science as a way to do this, as an organisation whose regulatory work is underpinned by science. We asked the community what concerns they had. They had this. This is Waterhole Creek, and it's filled with shopping trolleys. The community and local catchment management authorities were concerned about the health of the creek. No one was looking after what is a prominent natural feature of the town. We wanted to include the community, and not just in monitoring. We wanted them to help us design a project. What we learned through this process is that the community know the area. They understand their environment. They're concerned about its health, they're engaged, and they want to be part of the solution. How we do citizen science. The principles that underpin EPA citizen science are co-design, co-monitoring, co-interpretation, with the hope that this leads to shared understanding. This model aims to apply community knowledge through facilitating active participation in EPA science. Collaboratively design and implement projects that target local environmental issues, and importantly, create a two-way working relationship between EPA and the community that fosters trust, increases scientific literacy, and builds environmental awareness. Just move straight into co-design. So by co-design, we mean collaboratively designing a project with EPA scientists and community members. Some of our citizen scientists in the project have lived in the region for 60 years. They've worked in the energy and mining industries prominent in the valley. Their knowledge of the region contributed to well-selected sites that otherwise would have not been identified by EPA. Sites selected for the program were influenced by the interest of citizen scientists and their knowledge of the industrial history of the region. Using this knowledge, EPA freshwater scientists were able to suggest appropriate sampling methods for the creek and for this study. Co-monitoring. To complement regular monitoring, as I first described, the fortnightly monitoring at 10 sites, we also carried out advanced sampling. By advanced sampling, I mean EPA and citizen scientists together taking water samples and sediment samples that would then be analysed at a lab. As discussed in the last slide, these samples were identified by community knowledge and EPA's own freshwater interests. Co-interpretation. By co-interpretation, I mean EPA and citizen scientists interpreting and analysing the data collected. Our experience of co-interpretation in Waterhole Creek was a prime example that you don't always get things right the first time. We trialled our first co-interpretation session in June. That resulted in a one-sided interpretation, where citizen scientists lacked the confidence to interpret data and contribute to the discussion. We had not understood whether the information we presented would be coherent to the group. This experience taught us a lot. The next session, we created a workshop. We gave citizen scientists organized data, color-coded and clear. They analyzed it, mapped it, identified trends and hotspots, and visualized the results. And then they had the opportunity to discuss this with our freshwater scientists. What resulted from this was our citizen scientists describing the results to our freshwater scientists, who were then able to confirm and corroborate results and provide further advice and on the hotspots and trends identified by citizen scientists. What we saw in this session is when you give people the right tools, the appropriate level of information, and a collaborative space, you create an appropriate environment to facilitate discussion. When this environment is created, citizen scientists are empowered. An outcome of this process was true co-interpretation, equal interpretation and a shared understanding of the data that was collected. The skills and confidence shown in this workshop was unprecedented. Comes to shared understanding. If I get anything out of this slide, it's that we created a two-way working relationship that increased trust, and this worked two ways, between the community and EPA. And the experience and knowledge provided by citizen scientists and EPA was of equal value. Just to finish, lessons for next time, and just lessons overall, include the people affected. Understand why they are there and how they want to contribute. Anticipate limitations, your own as an organisation and the people that you're engaging with. And lastly, be flexible. As a government organisation, you have to learn to relinquish control for this process to work. Involving community members in co-designing, co-interpretation and co-monitoring can be more resource intensive to start. However, when you involve people in all parts of the process, that is when you harvest community knowledge. That is when you create collaborative partnerships, strong science, trust, and an engaged community.